Okay, let's get started with this new workshop on the code library. So, for those of you who were with us last time, we focused more on the code library itself. Today, we will explore some of the new resources. And the new thing on the code library now is that you can see which resources are new because as time as the resources are added, it can be hard to keep track of what is added, what is new, and what is old. So we added some notifications around here, so you can see the new resources in the components or and where they are located. We will go through the KPIs just after that. And you can now also have a list of the latest resources, and you can subscribe to this list via RSS. So you can do that through Slack, Feedly, or any of your favorite reader. You can use a browser extension, so you can have a notification when a new resource is added. The first resource we're gonna explore is the Flip KPI, a new kind of KPI we will go quickly through. And then Fred will be showing you the listing generator, which is a no-code tool you can use for building web pages that has been quite su successful in the last months. So the Flip KPI is a KPI that is designed so on first look it's a KPI card as any other, but sometimes you might want to share more information about the KPI itself. How is it computed? Which data set it's from? So if you stack all this information on the card itself, it becomes quite packed and visually heavy. But if you don't add this information, sometimes the information can be a bit too raw. Just the KPI itself can be a bit imprecise. So this KPI allow you to have the main information on the front of the card, and then to flip it and have some more information on the back, so that you can have a very slick front face and then a more detailed back face. So how does this resource work? As with any of the resources on the code library, you can click the Edit on Code Pen button here, and it will go to a playground where you can modify and test your component very quickly without the overhead of setting up a new page and all the kind of debugging work. So this component is always embedded in a card flip class. So you have a parent element marked with the card flip class that wraps everything into it, and inside this element you will have two faces of the card. The first one is the card face front, okay, which also inherits the KPI card and the card face classes because it's a KPI card and it's a card face. The second part, which is a direct child of the KP, of the card flip, is the card face back, which is located somewhere over here. So it's this one. It's also a KPI card. It's also a card face, but it's a card face back, which has different properties around here, and it contains all the information you need on the back of your card. So on the CSS, what you might want to look at is that so everything is wrapped into the card flip component here, and as you can see, this is 100% percent eight and width. So you don't have to change the height and width of the card itself. You always wrap it into a parent element that has the desired height and width. So here we are using Bootstrap's row and col that you might be familiar with. So the row will set a minimum height, and we are setting a width of four columns. If we want to change that, we can just, for example, inlining the style. So I'm inlining a style for the sake of demonstration here, but normally you would do that into a CSS class. Okay, so right now the width is 200 pixels. Okay, so let's revert back to what we had. Okay, and you can flip that. If you want to change some of the shadows, for example, the box shadows on over might be a good example, then you will look for the card flip over, because like everything is wrapped into the card flip, and on over it give an hint that something might happen when you click it. But if you don't like that, you can just remove the box shadow. Okay, and it will just have that back. Okay, so we can also, there are many things we can change on that. For example, you might want to add a bit more, you might want to add a bit more hints. So let's add right here some 30 degrees to make it very obvious that when you hover the card, you know it will slightly angle like this. So I put 30 degrees here to exaggerate the effect, but you might want to put some lower value or lower or higher. So everything is prefixed in this CSS example. So sometimes you have to modify both value with the vendor prefix, but this ensures that because this resource uses some advanced CSS capabilities based on the rotation and the backface visibility of elements, we need those vendor prefix so that we have a large browser compatibility. So now what happened if I want a second one? Here I will just copy paste the whole element, including the layout wrapper. Here this is the one that says it's four columns of width. And if we just paste a second one, we have two KPI here. And when I flip one, okay, the second one doesn't. So both have their own scope for flipping when you click on them. Don't be don't be afraid of copy pasting the same. So you might want to have different dataset context for both cards. In which case, copy. Having a new ODS dataset context tag feels natural. But if you are using the same dataset, you want to copy that as well. Also, it's the same. It will make only one call to the API. So it's much easier to copy the ODS, everything that is inside the dataset context, and just copy paste this block as much as you want, even if it doesn't change. Now you might sometimes want to sync the flip. So if you click one card, all of the cards will flip at the same time. And this is why the second resources here will be for. So we added. Since we are stacking more resources, we've had We've added this menu on the left so that you can navigate more easily. I hope you like it. Feel free to leave us some feedback about that. So this KPI sync flip will flip both cards at the same time, or if you have 10 cards, it will flip all 10 of them. So this is done just for those who want a bit more of technical context. In the previous example, with the ODS dataset context, each card had its own scope for the variable that stored the state of the card being flipped or not. Right here, what we do is that we lift the state outside of the ODS dataset context into this variable object here. And so when we change one, it's stored into a bigger context and it is shared between both components. Okay, so in the first one, each component has its own little bubble where the state is managed independently. And in the synced one, we lift the state so that everything is into the same bubble for sharing the state. So this explanation was just to go a bit more into the details of how it works. You don't need to actually understand that to make use of these resources, as scopes in Angular are quite a difficult topic that we get lost into ourselves too sometimes. So don't be afraid if you if it seems sometimes a bit shadowy. This is the same for everybody. Okay, so this was the KPI flip. Simple and efficient resources to display more information while keeping a slick interface. And now I will leave the end to Fred for presenting what has been a huge success on many pages, the listing generator.
Thank you, Etienne. So I will try to share my screen. Should be good.
Yeah, it is.
It's fine. Okay, thank you. So listing the okay generators have their own section on like you can see on the left on the code library, because they are part of kind of no code templates. So I will explain. It's full page templates, so they have their own layouts, own blocks. They have most of them a search bar, filters, a way to present the information. And the idea is that you will not be forced to modify the code itself. You will just need to provide settings, just the dataset ID you want to use, the list of fields IDs that you want to use, if there is a date or etc. etc. And the idea is that the template will automatically display the information according to your settings. And this is why it has a great success, because it's really simple to deploy and to reuse on top of your data. So here, for example, the main one, it's also because it's the first one, it's the listing generator. So it fits with all kind of data that needs to be listed. So it works really well with cultural associations or sports associations, with elected representatives in your city, if you want to list them and display their pictures and different information, be able to search among them or filter depending on their party or whatever. We have a lot of customers that are using this template to share deliberations of the municipal council. So it's pretty convenient. So I will show you some examples. On the code library here, you can see that the first example is a data set of paintings from the artist Vermeer. So I pronounce it in French, so I don't know in your language how you pronounce it, so sorry for that. You have on this template a search bar, some filters, you have some KPIs. Here you have the count, so the number of paintings in the dataset, and some computation, some aggregation. So here it's the average size of the paintings. And you can see the list here. Another example is about it's talking about events in Paris. The main difference it will be the place of the picture, and most of all a slider to select the date, the range, the starting date of the event. So what I propose to do now is to pick up a dataset on our data network and take the code and set it up on this dataset. So let's go. When you want to make some tests about a resource, like Etienne said, we often use the edit on CodePen button because it's pretty convenient. One click and you have a development, a light development environment to make your tests. So I'm starting from this example, and if we have a look at the code, I won't modify the code. I will only have a look to the settings. So the settings are at the beginning of the HTML code, and we can see a lot of things. So it looks a bit heavy, but you will see we will modify a few lines, and it will work pretty well. So the settings, we need to provide a domain, a dataset ID to tell the template which data we want to use. We need to provide a list of filters that will be translated into these filters here. So behind it's ODS select widget. For those who already use this widget, you can provide a field date. Here, there is none. You can set the kind of view. Here, we want a cards display. We have also a table view. We provide the list of fields that we want to see in the card here. So title, collection, etc. The title of the card. So it's bolder and at the top of the card. We can provide KPIs and all that stuff. We will come back to the KPIs later. So I go to the data network, and one data set that I have that I like is the public art data set of Vancouver. Up. Where it's an image data set, and you can see all the statue, paintings, mural, artwork, etc. in the city of Vancouver. And this data set is really nice because you have tons of information. You have the location, but you also you have some filters to refine your search. You have the images, of course, to see them. For each record, you have the type, the statue, the site name, the neighborhood, the ownership, etc., etc. And also, quite interesting, you have the link to see, get more information, and go on the public art registry, that is the city application for this topic. So. Let's use this one. I like to go on the portal itself. So when you are on the data network, I don't know if you already noticed, but you have a metadata source with a link. It helps you to go on the real portal to see the data set. So let's go. I take the dataset ID and I go back to my code. I paste it here. I then take the domain here I remove all this stuff because the template will compute build the URL itself, so we don't need to put the HTTP and all that stuff. We will remove all these. I will just empty a bit all the existing field IDs that are not correct for in our case. Just clean it up. I will remove the KPI blocks. You will see, for example, if I remove this block, it will just remove the KPIs. So if you don't need a feature of the template, you just remove the corresponding setting and it will remove it from the page. Fine. So for now, I just have the dataset ID. So you see that the template is getting the title and the description of the dataset and provide a search bar. So now I will add some filters. So how can we filter our data set? We can propose a type of art, for example, the material. It's nice if I want to look for bronze or paintings or whatever. And the neighborhood. So I will go to the data schema tab and get the idea of my fields. So the filters, the filter list, it's a block like this. It asks for the ID, and you have an option to say if it's a multiple filter or not. If you can select multiple values or not, I will add three filters. So I say I want the type, and you see each time I modify the settings, you have the reload on the right, and you have your type filter that just appeared. The type. With the primary material and the last one, I set the neighborhood here. Fine. We have no dates, so I let it blank. I want the card view. Fine. So regarding the fields. I want to display, what do I have? I go to the table view to see. We have the type, we have the site name, the status, if it's removed or in place, site name, site address, these kind of things, and the ownership. Okay, let's take these fields. So, the status, the ownership, for example. It respects the order, so just set in the set the order that you would like to see. What they say, the site name, site address, for example. Well, just the site name, it would be fine. Okay, and I can see my cards that starts to be much nicer. Now then I can set a title, like I said. So maybe the site name, I want it as a title, so I will remove it from here, in fact, and set it here. I can specify the field if you have images. So it's, in our case, the file type here, it's photo URL. So I will set this settings field photo to my URL, and you will see the image appear. Perfect. You have a different position on the left or on top. For all possible values, you have the full documentation just below. You can see here you have every field, every possible field, every possible options. If, for example, image position of the, in the card can be top or left. So if I want to switch to top, it's possible. I can just switch the value, wait a bit for CodePen to refresh my code, and it's fine. Okay. You can set the number of rows, for example, if you want to switch to three, extra, extra. So you can guess what it will do. Voilà. You can see that you can already start to use it if I want to see every art on Plaza, for example, that are in every kind of bronze, for example. And here we go. Okay. Now I can set a button to redirect the user to another site. And we saw in the dataset that we have a link, an external link. So here I can set the field link. If I set the field link, it will add a button in the card. So here we go. It's here, just URL. I paste it and I can set the label of my button. Simon, for example. Let's keep it simple. And voilà. We have our visualization, our nice listing visualization. You can search on it, you can filter on it, you can know more about a specific item, and it will open a new tab on Vancouver Public Art Registry service. Voilà. If you have any question, do not hesitate. No? I just try to check the question at the same time. Okay. If you go back to the code library, you will see that there is other kinds of generators. You have one that is a mix between a list and a map. It's more or less the same than the listing generator. It just add a map on the side to highlight coordinates if you have some in your data set. If the map is the main point of interest of your data, you have a more map-centric view. You have a full screen map and the same, the search bars, the filters, etc. on your left. You will see that every templates are responsive. So if I go back, if I take this template and edit it on CodePen, and I reduce my screen to a more or less tablet or phone view, it will switch to a mobile menu like this that you can unfold and fold to navigate. So it's the same for the listing generator. It will go back on one to narrow on one column and be able to display nicely on mobile devices. Voilà. And if I have a question, does the filters need to be a facet in the dataset? Very good question. Very good question. The API allows you to ask for facet results even if it's not a facet on the data set. So can we make the test? Artist project statement, for example, is it a facet? No, it's not a facet. I take this field, I add it in the list, I just copy paste this block and I will replace the field ID. And you see that it works. So here, I think it's the worst field possible for this kind of exercise, because clearly you see there is a lot of different values, so it doesn't work. But yes, the Open Data Software Platform API allows you to compute facets even if it hasn't been selected. But kind of there is some things that you can't do. For example, here, specifying a field date. If you specify a field that is not a date, that is a text, for example, it won't work, because specifying the right type for fields unlock features specifically for the dates, of course, for computing range of dates, for selecting range of dates, etc. So it won't work for everything, but here for the filters, it's fine. It's fine. Do I have some time? Yeah, maybe 5 more minutes. I will just show you for the KPIs block that I removed at the beginning. Here in my case, I don't have numerical fields apart from an ID, so it's not interesting to make some aggregation on that. But never mind, I will just make some account, a counter, just to see how many public arts we have. The idea is that behind it's an ODS aggregation widget. ODS aggregation helps you to compute the sum, the average, mean, max on numerical fields. So here, for example, in my settings, I have two blocks of settings. The one that is computing the average of a Felix star, that this one I will remove it because I can't do it with this data. And the other one, the function is count. So I'm just counting. So I will set as the title number of public art pieces, for example. I don't know. And I have my display. I can set an icon, like every icons on OpenDataSoft, it's based on font awesome. So I can pick an icon here. Location. I take very quickly an icon, a random icon, but maybe you will find something a bit better for this kind of data. I add the option FA icon and I set the value globe and I can set the icon like that. Again, you have the documentation below to see all the possible options, but voilà, we have our KPI like that. And of course, it's linked to our filters. So if I select some filters, you will see the number of public arts that correspond to this to my filters. Voilà. And if you want to see more examples of this for this kind of templates, you can go to the sources of inspiration datasets that all the customer team keep updated. You can see in this dataset on the user club a lot of different different work from our customers. So it's data sharing initiatives. You have templates from the code library, but not only a lot of stuff. So if you search for listing, you will see some nice example of how this template can be used. So here, for example, it's deliberations of the regional council. I really like this one. It's the map listing template that highlights the addresses of defibrillators in the city. You can see here, you can filter by locality, search, and see where the defibrillators are located. So pretty useful. The list of mayors, so the presentation of the members of the municipal college. Another use case quite nice is the job the available job the open position on the council. So you can see here, you can filter by direction, by service, what kind of grade level you are looking for, and you can apply if you are interested. Every kind of data that can be listed, in fact, can fit well for this template. Voilà. I'm looking at the question. Yes, Maria, we have. Could you make it flip when you hover it? This is a question for you, Etienne, for the flip KPI. Can we make it flip when
so
we
yes,
hover?
We can. I quickly answered in the chat that you could use. I thought you could use ng mouse hover. Which isn't right, because if you just then every time you move your mouse, it will flip again and again. So we have to do the pure CSS way. This is in some way simpler because you don't need to store the state of whether it's flipped or not. Now, what is complicated when you click is that your app has to remember at some point whether you clicked the component or not. Well, if you're doing that just With the other, you don't have to remember, because if you're overing it, then that's the state of your app. So you have nothing to the change. And so this one should work. Yep, indeed. Oh, it's a bit shattery. So what did I do? I removed the full section here. Maybe
can
I
we
can
see
show you.
Your screen? Or are you showing your screen? I don't know.
Yes, I think I am. No, yeah. No.
Okay, it works. Yes, perfect.
So what I did is to remove all the parts that says is flipped or not, and do the logic on that. I remove as well in the CSS the parts that say that flip and is flipped, because we were adding a special class for when it's flipped, but now we don't need that anymore. And in my cart flip over, I just add a rotation of 180 degrees instead of the 5 degrees that were here before, just for having a little hint. And now it's flipping on over. Okay. So the main difference, it's a bit chattery though, so maybe there is some more CSS to. Oh no, I know. And we have to comment out this one as well. Okay, so we have to, I think it will be better. Right, yeah, looks much better.
Maybe it can be a nice alternative and add it to the code library, because it can be nice.
Yeah, I think we will
for other people,
so
yeah.
It's a bit better when you are just on the edge, right? It will be, but if the over is frank, it will.
Okay.
I'll try to smooth it out, but this is the main idea I'm using here is that since the app doesn't have to remember your choice, then you don't need to do it in Angular, because there is no state involved here, and it's pure CSS to detect whether your pointer is overing the card or not. That's about it. We will add it as an example on the code library.
Perfect, thanks.
So any further questions? No, doesn't seem. Okay. Well then, thank you for attending. Let us know if you have any resources on which you would like a special workshop like this for, and see you for the next one, hopefully with a lot more new resources to share. Thanks.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.